who wouldn't like to receive such a commendation and praise, and that too from his or her teacher after a gap of nearly 4 decades. Ever since part 1 of Vishwas in Conversation with Vinod Bihari Mathur, chairman of India's National Biodiversity Authority, was released, his mailbox is flooded with many such praiseworthy comments and messages of congratulations. In this part 2 of Vishwas in Conversation with Vinod Bihari Mathur, we would be covering up the challenges and his vision for the National Biodiversity Authority, the National Biodiversity Mission, and then glimpses into his being a parent together with Dr. Geetika Mathur. And yes, if you have not subscribed to this channel yet, then do subscribe, and don't forget to press that bell icon so that you get early notification of the upcoming episodes. Years in WII, you superannuate, and next day you are in Delhi to take over as the chairman of the National Biodiversity Authorities.
That I will superannuate. That is the only date in life one knows. You don't know when you'll get married, and when you don't know when you'll get a child, and when you'll get this or that, or when you'll die. But everybody knows that you will superannuate on that given day. And one has to prepare for that. Okay. So very early on, I was preparing for that. And obviously, I knew that a person like me should be able to work beyond 60. It was very clear to me that I will be engaged in doing something productive, something useful. And this is also a fact which everybody should understand, that your reputation precedes your movement. Before you come to any place, in 8 or 9 out of 10 times, people will know who this person is and what he is going to deliver and what is his reputation. So your boss also observes you. He also knows that who is the person who will deliver. So to that extent, the reputation that here is a man who will deliver no matter what happens over there, and will apply his mind and be as objective as one can be. Not that I knew what a job of chairman NBA would be like, I must admit to you, but I knew that whatever job I am assigned, I will eventually do my best to do that. And there is conservation science is not a rocket science. You must have the basic understanding, and all my networking skills and human management skills will come handing to me. And as a chief executive, I can always ask for somebody's advice. So it was not that, but that it will transform the dramatic part. I must say that I retire on the evening of 31st of August, and first is a Sunday. And I'm the current minister. Talk to him. He says, "To aao na. Why don't you join?" I tell him that, "Sir, it is a Sunday." वो कहते वो कुछ नहीं है. आप आ जाओ दिल्ली में. आपको मेरे को एक वो देनी है, एक oath दिलानी है. हम oath दिलाएंगे and आप काम तक शुरू कर दो. And he had a point, because at that time the desertification COP was on. And he wanted that Indian delegation should negotiate nicely. And to be a part of Indian delegation, you had to be a serving official. So that was the need for me to be part of that. So that's what he does. He at 11 o'clock, I reach office and he administers the oath. And then I get cracking into the COP. And the last 9 months have been really hectic.
I would say the chief administrator of India's biodiversity. what kind of challenges that you foresee, both for biodiversity or for particularly for the NBA and NBA's role in ensuing period?
See, as a chairperson of the National Biodiversity Authority, my role as such is pretty cut out. When I say cut out, means we have, India has enacted a Biological Diversity Act 2002. And this act is the main legal instrument for regulating environmental activities in the country, particularly as it relates to access and benefit sharing of resources. So we are also signatory to the Convention on Biological Diversity, which has these three tenets: conserve biodiversity, sustainably use biodiversity, and have a fair and equitable sharing. So against this backdrop of the CBD, India has its own Biological Diversity Act, which I just mentioned. And this act is basically to implement the provisions of what we are saying internationally. Biodiversity Authority has threefold functions. It has to regulate the provisions of the law as enshrined in the act. It has also to facilitate the management of biological diversity. And the third part is the conservation part. So regulation, facilitation, conservation. These are the three words which describe the act and my role. But these are words. You can interpret them, Vishwas, in any way you like. Mm. You need to go, or I need to go beyond that. Because these acts have been created and enacted for a certain purpose. And that purpose is, to my mind, twofold. We have to make sure that conservation is supreme. It takes place in the first instance. Because if the resource itself is not protected, then nobody gains. You may have any act, you may have any law, you may do anything, but if the resource is getting depleted, and that is why you have seen that in the recent report of IBIS, a worrisome image has been given that there are about 1 million plant and animal species which are on the verge of extinction. And when I say verge of extinction, what is the comparative line? The comparative line is that if the business as usual continues, it is a matter of time only that these extinctions are likely to take place. Mm-hmm. But the challenge then is how to change the trajectory of this curve.
If you look at biodiversity governance in our country, there is a three-tier mechanism. At the top is the National Biodiversity Authority. Then we have the state biodiversity boards, and then we have the biodiversity management committees. Now, this three-tier arrangement is there to deliver, plan and deliver the governance of biological diversity. The important part is that if you look at the whole spectrum, you will also find that in our country, and very rightly and appropriately, the participatory governance has been pegged at the biodiversity management committee level. So these biodiversity management committees have to be set up at the Gram Panchayat level. So you can see that when we talk of governance is beginning at the top and going right up to the village level. And what is the instrument before us? That each biodiversity management committee has to formulate a people's biodiversity register. And this is a register, or this is a document which has many things. In simplest form, it is an inventorization of the resource, that what exists in a particular village and what abundance, whether it is plant or whether it is animal. And most importantly, the traditional knowledge. See, many times when we talk of biodiversity, we are talking in terms of flora and fauna, which everybody understands. But I must stress that it is this traditional knowledge or associated knowledge or associated and traditional knowledge, whatever way you define, is very critical in India's endeavor to conserve its biological diversity. So that is the big challenge before NBA and before I in particular. And you are aware that very recently, last August 2019, just a month before I joined, the Honorable National Green Tribunal, it passed out a judgment saying that all the biodiversity management committees and all the people's biodiversity registers have to be made or put in place by March 2020. So my first 9 months was like baptism with fire, because every month we had to engage with the states, and not one and two, but all 30, all 30 states and union territories. And I'm very pleased to say that with some bit of effort and support, we were able to establish almost 95% of the biodiversity management committees. So roughly about of the 2.75 lakhs that we have to constitute, we have done about 2.55 lakhs. Mm-hmm. So in numerical terms, we have been able to convince the Honorable Court. But on the People's Biodiversity Register, there is a long way to go. Mm-hmm. Their numbers are small. But here we are trying to explain that PBR is a dynamic document. It is not something that I write and we write, or somebody writes and says that here it is. That is not true with the biological resource. The very nature of a biological resource is that it can change. It is dynamic. And then it varies with season. But we have gone back to the Honorable NJT to say that it has to be treated as a work in progress. We have to collect seasonal data. And this is what is the first season data where states are collecting that. Having said that, and as you understand with your long innings in bioinformatics, that any data or any information which is, if not geographically referenced, if not in an electronic form, it has its own inherent limitation. And that is what has been the process to the entire PBR formations, which started with the enactment of Act from 2004-05 onwards, when we started making them. There are a couple of thousands of them, some nice as well, but they are in paper form. Mm-hmm. So the moment anything is in paper form, it then prescribes or comes with a limitation. And that is what I have now seen it as an opportunity, that we are, when we are now looking at reinventing or rejuvenating the entire process. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the entire thing, and we have been discussing with you and other colleagues, that can we talk of a EPBR framework, an electronic People's Biodiversity Register framework. So if you were to ask me my biggest challenge is to improve, enhance, institutionalize the biodiversity governance process. And when I say that, I have a roadmap in front. I have to, my vehicles are the people's, are the biodiversity management committees, and my tools and instruments are the electronic PBR. Mm-hmm. And that is what they have to be, as I said, in quantitative terms, we may have been able to meet the requirement of the NJT, but we now need to look at the quality part. So both quantity and quality is a challenge, and this challenge is no small challenge, because as you will know that correct identifying five species, whether they are of plants or birds or insect or mammal, is a challenging task. Mm-hmm. But a country like ours, we also need to look at innovative ways. Mm. And there are already, as we are seeing, innovative ways coming. There are, I'm parallelly drawing what are the good practices coming. So in your own state of Maharashtra, you would recall that when you shared with me a university circular saying that the NCC students or the NSS students or the volunteers can come together and help you out in making that. Mm-hmm. So we have to also say that while it is the domain of the Forest Department or of the SBB, our approach should be very inclusive in character. Mm. And big institutions like the ZSI, the BSI, the ICFRE, they have their own role to play. So I am almost like rewriting the rules of engagement with these big agencies. And then you are also aware that the big National Informatics Center, the Center for Advanced Computing in Pune, are also leaders in data handling. And they are these big entities, Government of India entities, which are there. Mm-hmm. So my role, I would say, is pretty cut out. The first 9 months were taken by the NJT. But the rest of my tenure, I now want to move and see that we not only satisfy in terms of quantity, but there is an element of quality in it. So yes, for a big country like ours, there will be variations, I'm aware. Mm. But can we bring all the states and the union territories at certain level and say that, yes, we have made a beginning and we are now in the process? Because if you don't even know what your resource is, how can you talk of the excess and benefit sharing when you don't know what is there to share? And this is what I must share with you, that in my 9 months here, 3 times I have appeared before the Parliamentary Committee on Science and Technology. And there are some 31 MPs in it. So for the first time, I would say that we have been put on a broad gaze that our efforts are to be streamlined, to be institutionalized. And I hope that we should be able to work with the larger scientific community in this country to usher in a kind of a revolution, if I can say so. And you and I also have been talking about the NISARC, that is the national initiative for resource governance, assessment of resource. So that initiative, I am very sure in the years to come, is going to be a game changer. In your own words, there are things like transformation, there are things like game changing. And here is what I totally subscribe, not just as a term or as a catchy phrase, but in reality, a clear roadmap of what we need to do. And if we are successful, even I will go to the extent of 30%, 40%, 50% successful, that would be a very, very strong contribution of India to the entire world. So that is what the challenge is, that you look at both the global efforts, you bring in the best of science, whether it is from one place or the other, and then take it down to the grassroots level. Everything from capacity building to resources to resource mobilization is a part of that. Right. And therefore, we need to work on multiple fronts.
And talking about the challenges as well as inclusivity that you spoke about, that NBA working with major stakeholders and major institutions of eminence, both internationally and nationally, there's one blessing that Vinod Mathur always has. He is at a right place at a right time. And I'm saying this because you arrived at NBA, and along the same time, there was this national biodiversity mission being conceived. And incidentally, you are the mission lead, and it provides both more challenges but yet more opportunities to blend and collaborate together. So how is National Biodiversity Mission, which is conceived by Prime Minister Science, Technology and Innovation Council, is going to pump into achieving the challenges before NBA specifically, but also before the country as such?
See, that's a very right question and a very right frame that you have put me in. Interestingly, for the biodiversity conservation community, I must first say that this is a very, very important initiative. In the last 50 years that we have been here and talking about conservation, never ever at the country level, at the level of the Prime Minister, at the level of Prime Minister's Council, has anything been talked about biodiversity conservation. So here is an opportunity right from the beginning. And I must say that this was one of the first orders which came to NBA. And as you already said that the Ministry of Environment took a call and said that yes, this will be anchored in the ministry and it will be hosted in NBA, and the chairperson NBA will be the mission leader. So my role again, as I said, as in terms of the BMCs and the PBR, in the context of NBM is also pretty cut out. And fortunately here, I have a backup of a big team of scientists led by Professor Kamal Bawa in Bangalore, and the think tank is behind that. So it started with them, but gradually we have opened up into a national mission. And apart from the meetings that I was doing for on the orders of NGT, in the last 8 to 9 months, we have been able to build up the structure of the NBM, the components of that, some components of that. Just because we are talking of that, I must also relate the present COVID-19 pandemic. See, this pandemic is last 6 months only. Okay, we are in the 7th month, if you count from January to July. Mm-hmm. But in our National Biodiversity Mission, there is already a subcomponent on One Health.
Hmm.
Already we are talking that our ability as a country to deal with these pandemics, which will come again and again in whatever frequency, is very limited. And therefore, we need to bring and see the human health, the wild animal health, and the environmental health as a single integrated entity.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what one of the components is looking at it. And so is our component on electronic PBR framework, which I just explained.
Mm-hmm.
And there are other components which are interrelated. And you are aware that the discussions we had on the aspirational districts in the country.
Mm-hmm.
See, while the national mission is pan-India,
mm-hmm.
it will roll out to all the states and all the union territories.
Mm-hmm.
But our country has identified 117 aspirational districts. These are the districts which, for various reasons, the benefits of so-called development have not gone.
Mm-hmm.
So they are, from all social, economic, ecological standpoints, are backward or marginalized. And it is these districts which our country has to focus. And that is what NBM is going to do. And you are aware that we are taking small baby steps. But imagine a situation where even if we talk of the PBRs, mm-hmm. at least for these 117 districts,
mm-hmm.
eventually we have to make for all 732 or whatever districts we have. But can we do that? Can mm-hmm. we talk of integration? Can we talk of convergence, at mm-hmm. least in the context of these 117 districts? Can we have our electronic PBRs for these 117? Can we build in the concept of bioeconomy in that? Can we also document our medicinal value or plant value in these? So I see the possibilities are enormous. And here again, the path has been very ably cut out. The challenge will be to walk the talk, as they say.
Mm-hmm.
But I am prepared.
Okay.
That if NBA has been reposed faith by the federal government or the central government, and if the chairperson is the mission lead, then I would be failing in my duty if I quit my term without achieving a substantial part of the NBM as well.
And you have said it pretty rightly and aptly that you know, the roadmap is well cut out. And from my own experience of over 3 decades work in Indian biodiversity as well as globally, I wasn't much proud or feeling happier than these past 1 year, where for the first time in independent India, the scientific diaspora across the country came together and ensured that the Prime Minister's Scientific Technology and Innovation Council felt the need to have a national mission on biodiversity, which never happened. And I think that itself is a humongous achievement. But also that in the consultative process, there might be several universities, small individual researchers, whom the NBM consultations may not have reached. How could these small groups, small institutions, some university departments or colleges could be part of NBM when it will be fully rolled out? So what kind of features or programs or projects, opportunities to collaborate, investigate or enhance the capacities are there within the NBM programs? Can you elucidate on that?
See, first I have to explain a little philosophy. And that philosophy is like that. I will explain it in Hindi first and then we can do a little translation.
Mm-hmm.
See, there is a thing called Niyam. There is a thing called Niti. And so you need to have a legal framework. You need to have a policy. You need to have legal instruments over there. Mm-hmm. But the Niyam and the Niti have no meaning if there is no Niyat.
Mm-hmm.
And Niyat is what, to my colleagues who don't understand Hindi, is the intent.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the very important thing for me, that the same set of rules are there for everyone. But if you don't have the intent to do that, then you will always cite one thing or the other and say, this is constraint, this is a challenge, this cannot happen, that cannot happen.
Mm-hmm.
So what I want to tell you is that there is a very strong element of intent here.
Mm-hmm.
That this mission which has come and this mission which has to be implemented, it has to be implemented taking in mind the inclusive character, which is again what I stand for, the inclusivity part of it. And inclusivity, as there are other catchwords, leave no one behind. That is another way of saying that. So whether you are a small local college or whether you are an established university or whether you are a national institute like the ZSI or BSI, everybody has to pitch in with their own might at their own strength.
Mm-hmm.
So if ZSI, BSI can identify all species or practically all species, a local college, a local biology teacher should be able to do 5 or 10 for me.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what is, and you can see now the connect that we are now talking, and again to quote the Prime Minister, from global to local. So while the big, your previous former entity GBIF operates at the global level, what can GBIF do if the local entities are not in line with that?
Mm-hmm.
So here is a golden opportunity for us, for the entire conservation community, at whatever tiers of governance that you are there,
mm-hmm.
that come together, contribute to it, and in your own ways. And see this, my earlier thoughts about the PBR.
Mm-hmm.
So that is going to be the document for future, because it will have the resource governance part into it. It will have the inventory of it. It will also have the traditional knowledge into it. I am very sure, as we have been discussing, India might be among the top or maybe the first country in the world to put this framework together, not only together, but to see it being implemented. Because NBM is all about implementation. It is not that you conceive a theoretical model and you show it on a flow chart that this is going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
So see how ideally we are placed. We have the backing of the law. We have the mandate of the institution.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a willingness of people like you and me to take it forward.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to ensure that we take everybody together, interact with people, engage people, empower. The element of citizen science also is very high in the National Biodiversity Mission.
Mm-hmm.
So all small little, as we say, clogs in the wheel mm-hmm. are there. We need to make them work.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what is the commitment of the NBA. I want to reach out to all my friends and people and the youth in particular that do not feel that you will not be able to contribute. You will. If you are a student of science or biology in particular, you need not lament that you did not join medicine. Here is an opportunity again that our scientists, our pure scientists, our biologists can contribute in this national endeavor.
Talking about a youth, definitely both of your sons are in research themselves and pursuing their leading their life with a glory. What kind of key secrets of your own success you would be able to share with them? Because many, what would be your mantra to them?
See, it is a long and personal story. Now that you have asked me, I would first say that being a student of science, I understand the value of genetics. And you will realize that all of us as a student of ninth grade were told that there is a genetic part of heredity and there is a phenotypic part of the heredity. Yeah, very, very interestingly, I'm going to relate that. So see, my two children are my own children. So definitely the genetic part is the same. But the flavor they have given me in my life is very, very different. So each one has his own career progression and has evolved into a different being. So let me begin with the elder one. His name Vinayak. And very early on in his career, he decided that he has to study, like me, biology. Now you see the children can take maths and biology. So now the combination has moved from PCB to PCMB. You can have both maths and biology together. So that is what he takes. So he takes a call and says, I will study both. And obviously, the opportunities for good students are higher if you take mathematics. So the number of colleges are more and number of opportunities are more. So he takes that. Towards the class 12th, where he has to now appear for exams, he says, okay, he can go in for an engineering degree, but his degree will be in biotechnology. So we are wondering from where you have got and what you have got, we don't ask. So, but he says, I have done that. And then he picks up Manipal, which is one of the top rank school for biotechnology. And he goes there, he studies there. And now we are dreaming that our child will become an engineer. Because if you have a B.Tech degree, what you will do? You will expect that, yes, he will land up over there. And towards the end of his fourth year, when they have to take a semester long project and the interim vacation period, he says that he now wants to study evolution. Now we are wondering, evolution is not being taught as any subject in Manipal, but he says that I want to study evolution. I want to study ecology and I want to look at all these aspects of research. So we wonder what is to be done. And he has this 2 month long vacation. And in that vacation, what we do then that he gets an opportunity to go to University of Chicago and under a very famous scientist called Dr. Trevor Price, who is an authority in ornithology. And I should tell you that part also. So when I write to him that, Trevor, this is what I want to do, he says, well, we can do one thing. Chicago is closed during the Christmas vacation. And I have a postdoc. And that postdoc can provide some assistance. But there is a condition. So the condition is that one of his postdoc was going on a holiday, on a Christmas holiday. And he had two pets in form of kittens. And those kittens have to be fed every day. So he says that if he stays in his home and feeds the kitten, The other postdoc can take him every day to the museum. And we are now running a global project where we are trying to extract the DNA from museum specimens. So he can learn that, do some daytime work, and also do this small bit of household chore. But he tells that it is going to be miserably cold in Chicago in the month of December. So he should be prepared. So we tell these things, and he says, yes, yes, I can do it. And like a youngster, we said, okay. And whatever woolens we can give, he goes over there. He spends 4 weeks in Chicago. See, he comes back with a very strong motivation. And in one line, he says, this is exactly what I want to do. What? I want to do research. I will enter in the domain of pure evolutionary biology, stroke molecular biology, molecular genetics. And he says that I have now found out that I have to write a GRE exam, and I have to have my higher scores, and I have to compete. And so gets into the business. So about 15 universities he applies over there of different kind, which have a good name in ecology and evolution and so on and so forth. And interestingly, he gets offers from three universities, but the best offer comes from University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. And I am now talking of when the US is going under what is it called, recession, they are willing to pay for the travel. So he actually paid to appear in that interview, and they invite him to come with the other 14 on a Thursday afternoon or something, and then it continues. And they, the dean in his opening remarks says that we have all the money in the world. Our students do not have to stand for 1 hour at a McDonald's. But you have to convince us that you have the ability to be a doctoral student at UPenn. So then the process starts. At the end, they say that coming week, you will hear from our dean informally. Then in 5 days' time, he gets a letter from the dean that you have been selected as a doctoral student and with full funding. So he goes to Philadelphia, and for 6 years, he is holed up in a small lab, what they call as a bench, maybe a 6 feet by 3 feet space with some lab basic equipment. And Vishwas, you will recall that his work is on Drosophila genetics. That small fruit fly. Started in the 60s when we were working. That time also everybody knew that genetics means Drosophila genetics, you need to work. So he says, I don't want to do any industry. I don't want to do anything commercial. I will want to pursue. And I now want to join a teaching cum research position. So see, that is how the career is evolving. And for doing that, in United States, you have to do a 2 years postdoc before you can be considered. So from his PhD, he goes to George Washington University in Washington, does his 2 years postdoc. And at the end of his postdoc, he gets a tenure position in a university in Philadelphia. So see, his story is very simple. Success doesn't have one single reason. So is the failure. Failure also doesn't have one single reason. There are multiple reasons. But the most important reason is the motivation of the child. If the child himself or herself is not motivated, no amount of parental pressure can work. See, as I look back at Vinayak's upbringing, his early career, his way of dealing things, one thing is very evident. You mentioned I stressed upon the importance of discipline in life. And that is what I realized, that whether through genetics or through phenotypic, those characteristics have gone into him. So that respect for law came very early on. And that was so much evident that even when nobody is watching, see, that is the beauty of the thing. So if the policeman is standing and if you don't cross the red light, then it is understood. But imagine a situation when the policeman is not there and then also you follow the zebra crossing. So that is what I realized he picked up very early on in his very, very early formative years. And that has continued to this day. So that is his biggest strength, that he is a top of the line rule abider. And that is now reflected in everything that he does. He plans things, he works for them, and he will be very straight in his dealing. If he likes it, he will do it. If he doesn't like it, he will not do it. And nobody can get anything wrong out of him in whatever hurry and whatever pressure you might be. So these were the kind of things which continued. And then he set up goals for himself. And as I was mentioning, that guidance is okay, but a child has to be self-motivated. This is my biggest learning, that things were easy for us because he himself was disciplined and self-motivated. So with a little guidance, he moved much further and faster than anybody else. So my message then is that we have to inculcate the discipline. We have to and again, self-discipline. No amount of you, I, or teacher or policeman saying, don't do this, will work unless there is an inherent desire to be disciplined. So that was, again, we saw in him, it was there. And then once you decide, once you are motivated, then you walk through that path. And as we always hear that, walk the talk. And that is what exactly he has done. That and in cricket, we say play with a straight bat. So here is a child who plays with a straight bat, and then he has got results. And then, see, there is one more thing I want to say and share with you. Success begets success. So once you succeed early in life, you then want to maintain it. You create a reputation, you create an aura that this guy is a is an achiever. So every time you do that, you feel that you are bound to do that, and there is no going back. And therefore, you get further inspiration to do well. And that has been his case all through.
Storyteller as he is, we continued our conversation for another hour. We spoke about his younger son, the role that Geetika has played in success of Mathur family, but at the same time, to stood up as an individual personality in her own rights. And finally, the message that Vinod has for the youth of India. So stay tuned for part 3 of Vishwas in Conversation with Dr. Vinod Bihari Mathur, Chairman of India's National Biodiversity.